A giant silver ribbon of a fish is said to be a prophet of doom. In Japanese folklore, they're messengers from the gods, telling beach dwellers a simple message: run for your lives. They were seen in large numbers before the 2011 tsunami, and we're starting to see them again. What message do they bring this time? This is the Oarfish.
Hi, I'm Danielle Dufault, and you're watching Animalogic. Oarfish are showing up on beaches all over the world. Should we be taking this as a sign of the end of times? Hopefully not. Let's take a look into what makes this fish such a spooky sight.
The oarfish is the longest bony fish in the world. Full-grown adults get to about 8 meters long on average, but there are confirmed sightings of 11-meter-long individuals. That's about 3 great white sharks long. There are also unconfirmed reports of oarfish 17 meters long, or about 5 great white sharks. Next time you're looking for oarfish at the beach, make sure to bring your Raycon earbuds, the sponsor of today's episode. Raycon's everyday earbuds are the perfect tool for every activity. I listen to music when I draw and put on podcasts when I'm out nature watching. They even have active noise cancellation, which is usually a pricey feature, but Raycons are only about half the price as other premium audio brands. I'm not even a huge gearhead, but I like my Raycons for 2 very practical reasons. They're comfy and cute as heck. Before I had these Raycons, I worried about having to charge wireless earbuds all the time, but these ones have a battery that lasts up to 32 hours. And when the battery runs out, you can charge them super quickly. 10 minutes of charging time gives you 90 minutes of battery. They come with different gel tips, so you can find the perfect size for you. When earbuds are too big, they make your ears hurt, and when they're too tiny, they fall out too easily. But with these gel tips, you can make sure that they fit properly and comfortably. And the cases are not only pretty, but can also charge wirelessly, so you don't have to worry about having to carry cables. You can see why I wear them every day. Go to buyraycon.com/animalogic15 or click on the link in the description to get a 15% discount on any item in the website. I'm sure you'll like them as much as I do.
If you somehow managed to teach an oarfish to walk on land on its anal fins, it would be taller than a giraffe.
Or about as tall as this palm tree. Just to further illustrate how massive they are, take a look at this 5-meter-long fishy caught in Chile. Now, imagine one almost twice as long as this. That's how big they get. Despite being skinny enough that seafarers mistook them for mythical giant sea serpents, oarfish can be close to 300 kilos, or about the same as a polar bear.
So they're thin, long, and spooky, and are really just the fish version of Slender Man. Slender fish? Yeah.
It's really a ridiculously huge fish. But we really don't hear much about them because they're deep-water fish that only come up to the surface to die, or washed ashore already dead. It also helps that they have absolutely no interest in us. Despite their freaky size, they have a tiny mouth, optimized to eat krill and plankton.
Having said that, if you were scuba diving and one of these slender fish popped up out of nowhere, you'd be justified in being scared witless. They look ominous and less cartoony than other deep water weirdos.
They have an elegant, ribbon-like body with iridescent silvery skin, a crimson-red dorsal fin, 400 fin rays across its body, and a prickly red faux hawk crown on its head. It's an imposing body plan that has earned the slender fish the nickname the King of Herrings. And their genus, of which they're the only members, is called Regalicus due to their regal aura. And some scientists have reported oarfish giving electric shocks when touched.
They look like they could be Poseidon's pets. But anyway, you came here to find out if they're really prophets of doom. And the answer is obviously sometimes.
Oarfish live in waters up to 1,000 meters, as far as we know. They're not great swimmers due to their tiny, underdeveloped, royalty-like muscles. They also lack swim bladders to control their buoyancy. This makes them very susceptible to sea currents, which is sometimes caused by seismic activity. When the sea is angry, the current might push older, weaker, and sick individuals into shallower water, and eventually to the beach.
So if you've never seen this fish before, and suddenly a massive one washes up on your local beach, and then soon after an earthquake happens, you might be right in assuming that there's correlation, but there really isn't any causation.
This happened in Japan prior to the 2011 earthquake and tsunami. People started reporting sightings of this fish as early as 2009. About 20 oarfish were spotted before the earthquake, which reinforced the locals' belief that this was a soothsayer of destruction. This is a long-held belief, and they're even called the messengers from the sea god's palace.
Hey, see? Everyone thinks that they're regal to the point of being almost supernatural.
In 2024, oarfish were in the news a lot because three of them washed up on the shores of California. The Golden State lies next to the San Andreas Fault, which is part of the Ring of Fire, a huge belt where 90% of the world's earthquakes happen. So, yes, there was a clustering of oarfish sightings, and they coincidentally happened in an area of high seismic activity. But just to be super clear, this is a coincidence, unrelated to the tragic wildfires and other natural disasters. There are many possible reasons why we've seen so many oarfish recently. Water pollution, changes in temperature, noise pollution from sonars, a decrease in prey availability, diseases, or simply natural causes are factors that might lead to more oarfish dying in a certain area.
Also, the fact that almost everyone has a camera in their pocket these days makes it seem like there's been more sightings than there were in the past. Whereas before, a fisherman might have seen one overboard and thought to himself, "Oh, weird, a thunderfish," and never told anyone about it.
The mysteriousness of this fish is amplified by the fact that we almost never see them alive. They live too deep for us to dive and see them in person, and they're most commonly seen as bycatch in fishing nets. But submarines are getting more accessible, and Japanese and American scientists have managed to see them live, swimming weirdly in hypnotic, undulating motions, with their heads pointing up in what they describe as vertical swimming.
DNA studies have given us extra insight into their biology. Even though they were once called the king of herrings, they're actually landformers.
That means that they're more closely related to ribbonfish and crestfish, which makes sense. But surprisingly, also to Mola Mola. Fish family trees are weird. But though oarfish are Luigi to Mola Mola's Mario, the resemblance becomes more obvious when you take behavior into account. They're both slow-moving fish that eat very small prey. They don't chase anything, and are mostly unbothered by the whole obsession humans have for them. The doomfish are also important markers of the health of their ecosystems. Deep-sea habitats are often overlooked because we can't see them. But overfishing and contamination are leading to a sharp decline in population numbers. Thankfully, as technology advances, we are learning more and more about these amazing creatures.
They might be the stuff of legends, but oarfish are real, and they're some of the most incredible creatures in the ocean. If you happen to see one, please take lots of photos and videos. Citizen science can play a huge role in their conservation. Imagine, you could be the person who gives us amazing insights into the biology of the oarfish. So what should we talk about next? Please let me know in the comments, and don't forget to subscribe for new episodes every week. Thanks for watching, and see ya!